Good afternoon and welcome to this afternoon's presentation, Kitchen Botany, as part of our Florida Supernature series of lectures on the plants and animals and science in this part of the world in Florida. My name is James Stevenson. I'm with the University of Florida Institute of Food and Agricultural Sciences. We're a partnership with our local government to provide research-based information to our citizens to help them make informed choices. I'm coming to you from Brooker Creek Preserve. It's land set aside for the preservation of our native plant and animal species. But today, let's talk about some plants. Let's do some botany. And I'm gonna try my best to keep this from being too scary. I know botany sometimes as a discipline might freak some people out, but that's the whole point of today's presentation, to reinforce what you already know and how you can apply what you already know to native plants in the wild. At the basic level, plants are multicellular organisms, right? We get that, they're multicellular organisms. Cells are organized into different tissues and tissues are then organized into things called organs. And a multicellular organism has organs. Just you can name your own organs probably. Well, plants are no different. Being a multicellular organism, they have these three main ones. They have roots. That's an organ that helps to anchor most plants to the ground, access to water and nutrients from the soil. The stem, the part of the plant that stands up above the ground and presents the photosynthetic organs, the leaves, to the environment, so that through the magic of photosynthesis, plants can turn water and air into sugar and starch and other carbohydrates that we depend on. Most of the vegetables that we eat are actually made of these very plant materials. So those are the three main plant organs. Let's start with the roots, and we can take a look at some plant parts that we've had in our hands. A classic root vegetable would be the radish. And the radish, the name raphanus is what the Greeks used to call it. Sativus means that it's been cultivated, but radish is what we call it, of course. These swollen roots, that is starch that the radish plant has stored away so that during the first year of its life cycle, it stores up lots and lots of starch in its root. Radishes come from the temperate climate where winters can be quite cold. So it can overwinter. It can overwinter during a harsh period of the year, living off of those stored starches. The following year, it can use that reserve of starches to initiate the extension of the stem, the bud of the stem that will then shoot up, present leaves to the environment to collect sunlight, and then ultimately flower. And after flowering, the seeds are produced, and that's how this plant reproduces in the wild. Humans have taken a wild plant and exaggerated that trait, that this plant's ability to store that starch in its root over the cold months. Humans have been able to speed that process along and create the radish that we know today that doesn't take a whole year to store up those starches. It can do it in a very, very short amount of time. This plant is then harvested before it goes to flower, and we get to eat the starch out of these roots. Another root would be the parsnip. If you haven't tried parsnips, you might see or might know that they are related to carrots. They're like a sweet carrot. They don't have all that pigmentation in the root. The roots are generally pretty pale, kind of cream colored or yellowish. Pastinaca, again, an old name for the wild plant, and sativa would be the cultivated version of this plant, because we'll take a look in a second how different our cultivated plants can look than their wild counterparts. So again, it's the same process. The storage root is produced in 1 year to facilitate the flowering of the plant with the plenty of nutrient to get it through the difficult winter and initiate flowering, provide the nutrient for that flowering the following year. Probably the most famous root would be, of course, the carrot. Daucus, again, the old name for it. Carota, wonder where we got the common name. the big orange carrot that we're all familiar with the lacy leaves, if you've ever seen carrot leaves attached. Here's what wild carrot looks like. Yes, this is not that impressive, is it? So this just goes to show through selective breeding, what humans can and have done to wild species to create the vegetables and fruits that we have today. A carrot as we know it, that big orange stalk root, would not exist in the wild. That is the result of human genetic manipulation, not genetic engineering, that's slightly different. This is just selective breeding. Perhaps you've heard of that. I mean, look what we've done to dogs, right? That's selective breeding. Chihuahua is ultimately a descendant of a wolf through selective breeding. So here we have our wolf, the original carrot, as it were. And if you're familiar with, if you're from up east or maybe the panhandle, you might be familiar with this plant in the wild. This is Queen Anne's lace. So basically, if you're familiar with the wildflower Queen Anne's lace, it's the same species. So Queen Anne's lace looking like this, the domesticated carrot, same species, looking very, very different. And carrots have very plastic genetics. They have the ability to express lots of different genes through, again, through human genetic manipulation. And the pigments that can be found in carrots are, you can get this vast rainbow, and you can even buy these various colors of carrots these days. But the Queen Anne's lace, the Daucus carota, the wildflower, originated around this area, south of the Caspian Sea, and in what's now this area, Armenia, Azerbaijan, Iran, Turkmenistan, kind of around in there. That's where it was taken into cultivation, is how we refer to that. And the carrot that was created here in the East, was the purple color was favored. And so now the Eastern carrot, Daucus carota sativa, which means cultivated variety, Atropurpurea for that preferred purple pigment in the Eastern carrot. But this color is water soluble. This is kind of like cooking with beets, if anyone's ever cooked with beets, another important root with water soluble pigments. The pigment kind of gets everywhere. But apparently they don't mind. This is the carrot of the East. This is the carrot that they prefer. The orange carrot was developed literally by the Dutch. And does anyone know what the national color of Dutchland is? What is that? Holland? Yes, it's orange. And they created this vegetable as a sense, with a sense of national pride. And that is why we have orange carrots. And now we in the West all just expect carrots to be orange, but it was actually a conscious choice. So those are a couple of roots. Let's look at a stem or two. So the stem, again, is the part of the plant that's going to be above ground most often, is going to present the photosynthetic leaves to the environment to collect that sunlight. Asparagus is actually the growing stem of a perennial plant. A perennial plant is one that lives from year to year. And so asparagus from one plant can be harvested year after year. But asparagus only initiates this new growth once a year. So before we had worldwide trade in vegetables and year-round availability of these vegetables, asparagus was only available during a brief window of time when the cultivated plants were beginning their early season growth. And that kind of pushed the price up, made it a seasonal treat. But now again, since we have all kinds of international farming, we can take advantage of anybody's spring anywhere around the world while this plant is just emerging, and we can chop those succulent, tender growing stems off. Once the stems elongate, asparagus has this very frilly, ferny-like foliage. It's actually not a fern, it's a flowering plant. But here's what happens after they continue to grow and they bush out. Here's several rows of asparagus plants after they've been harvested. Not all the stems are harvested, so there can be enough stems presenting leaves to put some more storage carbohydrates in the roots so the plants can come up again the following year. So a perennial plant, one of our few perennial vegetables. Another stem, which might be surprising, you might consider a potato a root because it comes from underground, but it's actually the stem of a native Central and South American plant, Solanum tuberosum, which means it has these structures called tubers. And again, they're storage structures. And we all know how chock full of starch potatoes are, right? They're on your plate, they're referred to as a starch because they have this carbohydrate that the plants have created and stored away in their underground stems for their use year after year. Here we have this underground stem called the rhizome, and then the stem eventually forms these swellings, these tubers. And if the original plant does die back, we have these little underground ready to sprout propagules, which is really how this plant is using that starch to, again, go through a difficult season, perhaps a dry season, perhaps a winter. And these underground stems are ready with the branches that are going to come through the ground and produce the above ground part of the plant. And don't lie, this has happened to all of us, right? In the salad crisper, this stem has initiated its next year branching, and you can even see little roots coming off this branch. It's like it's made a cutting of itself, but it's still connected to this nice, rich starch source. So that's how that underground stem has evolved for the sake of the plant, and how we have turned the potato into a myriad of shapes, sizes, colors, and flavors to suit our needs. And for the next little while, we're going to pick on this poor thing. This is a wild plant. It's a European plant. It's actually scarce in the wild anymore. It's not that common anymore. There's only a few colonies of this plant called Brassica oleracea. This is what it looks like in the wild. There's some that grow on the cliffs in the United Kingdom, some up in Scotland, and scattered populations here and there. But this is a plant that the ancient people who lived where this plant was and is native, the people got their eye on this thing and realized how many crazy things they could do to it. And so let's take a look at some of the crazy things that we've done to poor little Brassica oleracea that just wants to live out its life and flower and produce seeds and so on. No, we're going to do this. We're going to take what would have been a flowering stalk with all the flowers that are going to become the seeds and force that plant to produce these kind of obscenely obese tissues that have absolutely zero use for the plant. We cover the tops so that photosynthesis can't happen, so that these stay nice and white, arguably inedible. But I think some people like, anyway, people like cauliflower. But look, it's just a crazy thing that we've done to a wild plant that has absolutely zero use to the wild plant. Here it is with its collar of leaves and that what was supposed to be flowering seed head tucked down in the middle. And we stop that process, harvest that stem and the flowering heads and eat it. Another version of Brassica oleracea, again, the same plant, but this time we have bred the plant, coaxed it into producing this swollen stem tissue. And you can see where the leaves are attached to the stem. But again, this has really no use to the plant. It's just the plant having a distorted growth habit that humans have taken advantage of and enhanced to form these, again, very starchy stem swellings that are an excellent vehicle for melted butter. Kohlrabi. Heard of kohlrabi? Kohlrabi? Another thing that we've done to the same species is we've made broccoli. This is a variety Italica. And again, like cauliflower, we've encouraged plants to have these thickened, unnaturally thick stems and very, very tightly packed flower buds. So what we have at the top of what would be the stem, we have the flower buds. And again, these flower buds, the unopened flowered buds and the extended stems are what we eat when we're eating broccoli. If the plant were allowed to flower, if we were to have this broccoli in our garden and didn't harvest it at this phase and instead let it elongate, it would go through a process that we call bolting. It would bolt up. And you can see the broccoli leaves here. And finally, the stem was allowed to elongate, the buds were allowed to develop, and the flowers open. And Brassica oleracea belongs to a group of plants that have these cross-shaped flowers, and they're given the name the crucifers. It's a family of plants, a lot of which we've taken into cultivation. But just this one Brassica oleracea species, we've done all these crazy things to. Radish is a cruciferous vegetable, if you will, which means cross-bearing, crucifer. And that's because of that cross-shaped flower. Is everyone okay? Is everyone following along all right? Are you doing okay? It's all right to talk to yourself. I hope you are. And we'll move on to the leaves of the plant. And these are pretty obvious. I mean, we can think of all the leafy vegetables that are a part of our diets, but look who it is. It's Brassica oleracea. Now what have we done? We have caused that poor plant to fold all of its leaves over on themselves instead of becoming a nice branching plant with presenting its leaves to the environment to collect sunlight. We've created a monster whose leaves kind of curl all over each other. Again, you would never walk out into a natural area and find something like a cabbage growing in the wild. It is just not, it can't survive on its own. Here we are again, Brassica oleracea. Perhaps the closest to the wild would be the collard greens. Closest to the wild, looking the most, these are the least manipulated, if you will. The only thing that's been done to this plant, this Brassica oleracea, is that it has been bred to have larger, thinner, less bitter leaves. And so those are the traits that were selected for when collards were quote unquote created. The same plant, again, only this time with curly leaves, is what we call kale. And now kale is in everything. I mean, you can't turn around without kale being in something. And it's just Brassica oleracea. I mean, you don't see, well, anyway, we'll leave that one there. But that's where kale comes from. It's a selected form of Brassica oleracea with these curly, crispy, crinkly leaves. If you dare give Brussels sprouts a try. This is another Brassica oleracea. And recently, within the past 10 years, there has been some backward breeding. So all of these, what are called cultivars of all these vegetables, have been developed over time. And mutations have continued to occur and selections have been made. It's why you can have many different varieties of cabbage. You know, there's Savoy cabbage, there's red cabbage, there's white cabbage. They're all the same thing. They've just had different traits selected for. So in the case of Brussels sprouts, Brassica oleracea, gemifera, which means it has lots of buds. And these are in fact the side shoots. After the plant would elongate or bolt, instead of having side branches, it's those side branches that fold in on each other, like the cabbage does, and form these tiny little bunched up buds. Anyway, so over time, Brussels sprouts have been selected for various traits, their flavor, their tenderness, their size, and whatever. But unfortunately, the most marketable Brussels sprouts, the ones that could travel the furthest for the longest period of time and not go bad and not get squished. Unfortunately, those Brussels sprouts were not really edible. I mean, and with some pretty dire side effects, which we won't talk about. Some breeders went back and looked at some older varieties that maybe didn't have all those marketable traits, didn't make them quite so bomb-proof. So they back-crossed and tried to get some sweetness and succulence and less wind-producing attributes while keeping those marketable traits. And so actually the most widely produced Brussels sprouts today are much more digestible, shall we say. So give them a try. So we'll leave Brassica oleracea alone. That's a lot of things that we did to one species. And we'll move on to our next leaf, lettuce. And of course, lettuce is probably the champion of the leafy vegetables. Lactuca, which means it has milk. Again, sativa, we've seen that come up over and over again, cultivated. We have native species of Lactuca right here in Florida. So it's a Northern Hemisphere genus, but this one plant was taken and put into cultivation, and we now know it as Lactuca sativa, and we've done quite a lot of things to Lactuca sativa as well. I'll mention the milk in just a second, the milky sap, the Lactuca, the lacto that gives its name Lactuca. It's a member of the daisy family, and you might be able to just picture these little daisies, or maybe they look more like dandelions to you, but they're related to those. They're not cruciferous vegetables. And here again are the different things that we've done to Lactuca sativa. We've done the same thing that we did to cabbage and caused the leaves to fold in all over themselves. We have the leafy lettuces that are growing more like real plants, the very, very tender bib lettuce or cob, I think it's called cobblers. It's just butter crunch. It's just really, really tender. So we have different selections of this as well, different cultivars, different varieties. The one that's closest to the wild, however, is the lettuce that's known as romaine. And romaine is the one lettuce that has had the least amount of latex, that milky sap that gives Lactuca its name. Is milky sap, right? It's, what's it called? Anyway, it causes allergies in some people. It's a latex, I got it. It's a latex, and some people are latex intolerant, and they can actually become allergic to, or simply are allergic to, romaine lettuce because it has had the least amount of that latex bred out. The other varieties are pretty much latex free. Here we have a cross section of an iceberg lettuce and all the crazy stuff that we've done causing this unnatural infolding of the leaves. Again, the leaves in the center are not going to be getting any photosynthesis whatsoever. The leaves are going to remain what we call etiolated, in a lack of sunlight. Plants are very, very weak. And being weak, it's going to be very tender, right? And not have very much color because it hasn't had any exposure to the sun, so the chlorophyll hasn't really been activated. But here we have the bunched up stem. And eventually, nature overcomes this nurture, as it were, these cultivars that we created. And the stem can break through all this mess. And again, we have this thing that's called bolting. And this is what a lot of community gardens look like right now, because everybody's early season lettuce has bolted and has gone, and it's expressing its flowers and its will to reproduce. Another leaf, which you might not consider a leafy vegetable, is, what is it? Celery. Exactly. So celery, we harvest celery before it's mature, before the stem elongates. So here we have on this side an illustration of a celery plant that's elongating. And you can see branching off the side are the individual leaves. And it's those individual leaves we have created monsters that have this part of the leaf, which is called the petiole. We've had the petiole engorged, enlarged, and that's the part that we eat, the leaf petiole, a part of the leaf. And after the plant does mature and bolt, it produces these inflorescences, these flowers that it uses to reproduce. So here we have these celery stalks, but they're not stalks, they're not stems. They are actually leaf bases that we eat. Hopefully we eat. I actually like celery. Anyway, once they flowered, celery is a member of the Queen Anne's lace family. If you remember the Queen Anne's lace, you can kind of see the similarity there, this flat-topped white inflorescence that consists of tiny little flowers. And we all know pollinators visit flowers. They get pollen, transfer it to another plant. Once that pollen is transferred, seeds are developed. Actually, fruit is developed, and inside the fruit are the seeds. And celery is not only grown for its leaf petioles, but it's also grown for its seeds. In this case, celery seed. They're actually individual fruits. They're just dry fruits with a single seed inside. Kind of like a sunflower seed is actually a fruit, and the seed itself is inside. The seed itself is the part that we eat, but that's another class. Anyway, we'll call the celery seed. Celery seed is one of those seeds that humans have taken advantage of for being very, very fragrant, very, very flavorful. Seeds are full of self-defense mechanisms, because if something were to come along and eat this seed, is that seed going to germinate? Not if it's been chewed up. So we have quite a lot of seeds that have these defensive mechanisms. Plants can't get away, so they have to sit there and make their own defensive mechanisms, their own defensive chemicals. You know, plants are factories. They make sugar, they make starch, they make oxygen, but they also can make quite a lot of chemical compounds. And through the centuries, we have selected those plants with some of these defensive chemicals for our own quote unquote enjoyment and to flavor our foods. And that's what we call the spices. Spices, these defense chemicals, are most often toxins that the plant is trying to discourage anything from eating these vulnerable parts. The most vulnerable, of course, being the seed, because if the seed is consumed, chewed up, masticated, it's never going to germinate. So these are actually toxins. But we use them to flavor our foods. Some people even use these toxins medicinally, because of course, medicine is basically trying to kill the organism that's causing you distress. And so here we take these poisons in ourselves, and they don't affect us negatively in most cases. We could go on and on for an hour about spices, and we just might. Join us for Spice Science. We'll look at all the different spices and how they've been developed by plants for their defense, and how people have taken them and turned them into their flavorings and medicines. Another seed, since we're on the subject of seed, the grains, the seeds of the grass family. And we have very many different species. We have different varieties of zea maize, the corn, barley, all these other grasses. And their seeds also have certain compounds that are meant to discourage their being consumed. And some people are quite allergic to grains. You might have heard of that. So just another side note on plants producing things they don't want you to eat, and they're trying to keep you from eating them. But humans, of course, can use a sledgehammer to get around any obstacle like that. Not our last leaf, but our next to the last leaf is this one, kind of unassuming. This is spinach, spinachia, which is from the region that is now Italy. That's where this plant was taken into cultivation. Spinach also produces some defensive chemicals. Oxalic acid. It's meant to be so repulsive that you would never want to eat this plant. And, you know, some kids might have it right. Spinach could just be good. You know how it gets kind of squeaky on your teeth? That's the oxalic acid on your teeth. That's that plant's defense mechanism. But we all know how good spinach is for you. So again, we can soldier on, add some flavoring, some butter, some salt and pepper, and just try and ignore the oxalic acid. The spinach flowers are very, very tiny, wind pollinated, not insect pollinated. very kind of unassuming little plant. It looks very much like the wild spinachia. Again, you might think that the onion would be considered a root vegetable because onions, of course, are produced underground. These are actually storage leaves. And the stem is this little swelling down here. Do you remember the cross section of the lettuce, the iceberg lettuce? And we had that little dome of stem tissue that eventually is going to push up through and flower. That's exactly what's going on here in a completely different plant family. The onions are related to the lilies. And these underground overlapping storage leaves are what we consume. We don't know, there are many, many wild allium. There are many wild allium. We have native allium, but the genus is known for, in the presence of oxygen, producing this stuff that I can't say. So if this leaf tissue were damaged and exposed to oxygen that way, exposed to the air, it immediately produces this chemical that is meant to get in the eyes of whatever is trying to eat it and make it go away. Everyone's heard that onions make you cry. Well, it's crying out for its life is basically what it's doing. It's saying, stop, stop, stop. But we can't seem to get enough of that flavor, can we? Still okay? I'm gonna just have a quick sip of iced tea. Promise it's just iced tea. Okay, we're gonna crash on and we're gonna end up with these, the fruits. So we talked about flowering plants. They flower, they're visited by a pollinator, pollination takes place, a fruit develops, and inside the fruit is the seed. So we have all these familiar fruits. We have oranges, we have grapes. I said familiar and I can't name all of them. We have pineapple, but we also have peppers. Peppers are a fruit because they are a ripened ovary with seeds inside. That's what makes, botanically speaking, a fruit a fruit. Let's just go through this process using the example of the cherry trees. I hope you can all recognize that these are cherry trees. We have our cherry tree. We have our cherry flower here. We have all these words to describe the different parts of the flower here in cross section. What's most important are these stamens that have the pollen and this structure here. In the very center of all flowering plants, we have this structure. We have an ovary with egg cells inside, and each egg cell, once fertilized, once pollinated, becomes a seed, the reproductive structure of the plant. The stigma is where the pollen lands, where the pollinator brings the pollen actually grows down all the way around, up and into to find the egg to fertilize, to produce the seed. In real life, we can see the petals, the stamens, there's that stigma, the tube that the pollen's gonna grow down to get to this ovary. This is before pollination. Once the flowers are pollinated, we lose all those parts that are no longer necessary. We no longer need to attract any pollinators. The job is done, so the petals fall off. All the pollen has been shed so the anthers can fall off. But the ovary begins to develop. The ovary begins to grow, and that egg cell that's now becoming a seed is developing inside. Carrying on a little bit more, a little further into the ripening process, and we have a much bigger, more swollen ovary tissues with some nutrition for the developing seed. And also, once ripe, it's got something that's going to be attractive to an animal. In this case, the plant is actually producing something that it wants to be eaten, because in eating cherries, whatever animal eats the cherries is eventually going to have to pass its waste. And the cherry stone or the pit or the seed inside is going to pass right along with everything else and be planted wherever that waste has been deposited and grow into a new cherry tree. It's kind of an economy of scale. one cherry tree only needs one of its seeds to germinate and live until adulthood to have a successful life. And of course, cherry trees can live forever and ever, or for very many years. I shouldn't be so flip. Anyway, cherry belongs in a family of plants that give us a lot of fruits. Rose hips, you might be familiar with. Apples are in the rose family. Strawberries are in the rose family. So are raspberries and the stone fruits, including peaches. So that's a very fruity family. And again, these are wild plants that we have taken and made their fleshy, sweet tissue fleshier and sweeter to suit our needs. And, you know, there's at least 24 varieties of apples available in the United States alone. So these, again, humans have taken the elasticity, the plasticity of these plants' genetics to our own advantage. Another fruit that's going to challenge your idea of fruit, we have the ovary of a tomato. Once pollination takes place, the ovary takes over and all the other bits fall away. You can still see the little stigma stuck to the end of your tomato there, and all the eggs are developing into seeds. And here's the process from flower bud to flowering to the maturation of the ovary, which we call ripening. Tomato is in the Solanaceae. Solamen means solace or comfort. It means put you to sleep. A lot of these things are poisonous. A lot of parts of the tomato plant are actually poisonous, but it produces this fruit that's edible to facilitate its seed dispersal. But in the same family, we have eggplant. There's our potato is in this plant. This is a new world family. So these plants are not native to Europe or Asia. They're native to North and South America. The cucurbits, the melons, another fruity family. Again, the squash is a fruit because it's a ripened ovary with seeds inside. Cucumbers and all the different melons. These are all in the cucurbit family. All these different fruits. The cucumber itself, Cucumis sativus, it's been in cultivation for quite a long time. We believe that it was taken into cultivation in what is now India. The seeds and the skin can have a gaseous byproduct. And so there are cultivars, there are cucumbers that have been bred to have few to no seeds and very, very thin skin. Those are the English cucumbers or the hothouse cucumbers that are always wrapped individually in plastic. And our last fruit, the banana, the ubiquitous banana. This is the fruit of a cross between two different species of banana. A cross is when humans take the pollen from one plant and place it on the stigma of another plant that it would normally, naturally never reach, and create these hybrids, these things that rarely occur in nature and rarely survive if they do occur in nature. So this is an unnatural pairing of pollen and ovary from two separate species, Acuminata musa, being the genus here, Musa acuminata, which means pointy, and Musa balbiziana. Fruit is ripened ovary with seeds inside. And a fruit is meant to reproduce a plant. And here you can see a wild species of Musa doing what Musa wants to do, produce lots of seeds in a sweet pulp that's going to encourage something to eat it and pass the seeds through the digestive system to hopefully germinate another plant somewhere else. But the cross that we've made between these two species, of course, doesn't have any seeds. You might see some tiny little black flakes every once in a while. That is the plant desperately trying to express seed development, but this is a sterile hybrid between those two species. And this was developed and discovered and the production ramped up, but there are many other varieties of banana available. They are actually available. They might not look like our classic banana. There are other sterile hybrids that have few to no seeds, but they lack, in many cases, they lack that marketability. Remember when we were talking about the Brussels sprouts and the ones that were able to survive being shipped, being stored, and being put on a counter without rotting? That's what vegetable and fruit producers are going for. They don't care about the nutrition. They don't necessarily care about the flavor. What they care about is a product that can last between harvest and purchase, and not be blemished, because no one's going to buy anything blemished. These other cultivars or bananas are definitely worth trying. They might challenge what you expect a banana to look like, but they have qualities that, even though don't get them mass produced, doesn't mean that they don't exist at all. The bananas that we eat today are the result of a single hybrid that survived and produced fruit in adulthood. Every single grocery store banana that is grown in the world is a cutting from that one plant. Do you understand what I'm saying? What we're looking at here is a plantation of a single clone. These are all genetically identical. The problem, the benefit of that is we get bananas that are always going to be the same color, always going to be the same size, always going to be the same taste. We know exactly what we're going to get when we buy a yellow banana. The downside is that with this lack of genetic diversity, there's a disease. And if this plant does not have a genetic resistance to the disease, it's just going to take them all out. And that's exactly what's happening. We're actually on our second yellow banana cultivar. The first yellow banana cultivar was wiped out by disease. And luckily there was a second that was waiting in the wings that was similar enough to that first cultivar. Now we're on our second, and now our second cultivar is actually being wiped out by a disease. And eventually the cost of preventing that disease, and the cost not only financially, but environmentally, to controlling that disease is going to overwhelm, and we're going to have to move to another banana cultivar. Hopefully it will look just the same, because you know the human consumers, they like their yellow bananas. You know, they like things the way they are. I'm not going to go and eat a purple banana. Are you kidding? But the point there is that it's worth giving other fruits a try. Maybe just, you know, like it's the beginning of hurricane season, it could be the beginning of the end of the big yellow banana. Maybe start trying with some other banana cultivars or some other fruits that are more like their wild. They're less cultivated than the banana, less likely to be prone to such disease. Things like star fruit. Have you tried star fruit? Rambutan. These are mostly seasonal fruits, so it's really nice. You can switch things up throughout the year when these things are ripe. Tamarind, very, very sour. Mangoes, of course, we can actually grow a lot of these right here in Florida. Dragon fruit. Lychees are very similar to rambutan. So try something new. Just brace yourself for the eventual disappearance, as it were, of the banana, and spare a thought to the environmental toll that it does take to produce those giant yellow bananas. So I just redid my kitchen, being stuck at home. That's a lie. But anyway, I just wanted to say thanks for joining us this afternoon. Hope you got a little bit of facts to take away there. I'll put this next slide up with a big thank you. If you have any questions that you'd like to ask me today, any comments on the presentation, any complaints about going too fast or too slow or being ridiculous, or if you have any ideas for future presentations, please don't hesitate to contact me at jstevenson@pinellascounty.org. Our next presentation next week, we're going to take a break from plants, and we'll be talking about a family of birds called the woodpeckers. Yes, there are more than one kind of woodpecker. So we hope you'll see you then. And otherwise, I will just say good afternoon.